Circle of Life Coalition on BCTV is supported by the Berks County Area Agency on Aging.
Welcome to the Circle of Life Coalition program on BCTV. I'm Kathleen Bohannon, and I'm filling in for our regular host, Judy Wechter. For those of you who may not be familiar with a coalition, our mission is to educate the community on all aspects related to end-of-life care. We believe that it's extremely important for each of us to contemplate and communicate our own wishes about how we want to live our lives and how we want to die, but mostly about how we want to live our lives right up to the very end. And our topic tonight promotes just that philosophy. This evening, we're going to discuss the POLST form. POLST is an acronym that represents the Pennsylvania Orders for Life-Sustaining Treatment. And with that somewhat inarticulately said, I want to introduce our guest for this evening. He's a retired physician. He's an active member of the Circle of Life Coalition Advisory Board, and he's been a longtime member of the Circle of Life Coalition. And it's my great pleasure to say hello to Dr. Dan Kimball.
Thank you, Kathleen.
You're welcome. How are you tonight, Dr. Kimball?
I'm fine, thank you. Beautiful day.
Beautiful day. So, I know you have much information to share with us. This is a big topic.
Right.
And I'm wondering if we can just dive right into it.
Sure. So one of the things that we said we'd talk about is Pennsylvania life-sustaining therapy orders. What is this form about? And I think it's important for our listeners to understand that it is part of the whole process of advanced care planning, which we allude to in terms of people making decisions for their care at the end of life. Mm-hmm. But I want to lay the context for that even a little more in that most of our viewers have made such plans and they haven't identified it as such. So let's take any of us who, when we got married and we said to ourselves, gee, now that I'm married, how do I protect my family if something serious should happen to me? Maybe I better buy some life insurance. That's advanced care planning. That is horizon planning. That's what if planning. What if something happened to me? I'm concerned about protecting my family, so I'm going to get some life insurance. For our viewers who got their first driver's license, they may have been asked the question, if something catastrophic were to happen to you and you were a candidate, would you be willing to be an organ donor? That's a what-if question. That is an example of advanced care planning. So those, in that context, those are very common things. About 40-50% of people in the state of Pennsylvania have indicated their willingness to be an organ donor on their driver's license. I wish it was higher, and there are states that have done much better, but that's not our topic tonight. So I want people to understand the POLST process and the POLST form in the context of this advanced care planning. And traditionally, and we have talked on this program before about the concept of advanced directives. So this is a part of the continuum of the advanced care planning process, but to understand it, I think it's important to talk about advanced directives. So in the first graphic, which can be put up, people will see that advanced directives typically have at least two components. There may be other components as well, but the two important ones, the one on the left, which is abbreviated HCPOA, is the healthcare power of attorney, and on the right side, the living will. Those are the two common components. They can be done separately or they can be done in one document, which is often referred to as an advanced directive. The healthcare power of attorney process is where you designate an individual in Pennsylvania to act as your healthcare agent to speak on your behalf for medical decision making when you are no longer capable of doing so. And we can talk about variations on that, but that's the key concept. The living will is a list of your choices at the present time that says, these are my choices for end-of-life care should I be in a situation where I couldn't speak for myself. And that's the context of the advanced directive that we should understand the POLST in. The next graphic shows a continuum of the process. And I didn't get it to advance. Let me try again. There, it's working now. So this shows us on an age continuum from adult, it shows here age 18, all the way through our entire life. And our listeners will see that along the diagonal, there is the term conversation. And the reason I'm highlighting that is that it's so important not just to fill out these forms, but to have a conversation with significant others, family members, healthcare agents, about what you're putting in these documents. They are not as good if you don't have that kind of conversation. So that's why you see that term written on a diagonal under all of them. Now, only about a third of people in the United States have an advanced directive. We are encouraging all adults to have an advanced directive. You never know when you may be in a medical crisis situation where you cannot speak for yourself. So this is an opportunity for you to indicate what your wishes would be if you were in that situation. And your healthcare agent should know that as well. And then the slide shows that these should be updated periodically. We suggest that every 10 years, but part of that depends on the medical condition of the individual. And then the slide shows that, like most of us, as we move through life, we develop some significant medical problem or serious medical condition. And again, that should be a trigger for us to update the advanced directive document. And if it gets very severe, where your healthcare team would not be surprised if you were going to die in the next year or two, then the POLST form comes into play. So it differs from the advanced directive in a number of ways that we'll get into when we talk about the form.
Sure.
Does that make sense?
That makes sense, yes. Can we talk a little bit about the rationale for the POLST?
Sure. So on this next graphic, there are three issues that highlight the reasoning behind the need for the POLST form. First, the advanced directive may not be available when you, whatever crisis medical situation you're in. You may have not brought it to the hospital, you may be in a different state, any number of situations. And we've already indicated that about two-thirds of the U.S. citizens don't even complete them. And the ones who do complete them, they may not have it with them. The advanced directive that was developed may not have occurred in the context of the conversation that we alluded to. And so it's not a very worthwhile document, and it doesn't automatically translate into a medical order. So for those are the reasons that the document we think is important. So at a very high level, and it's going to be difficult for our viewers to see the writing, but I'm going to go over the form in larger print by section. But this form is printed on what's called pulsar pink, a wild pink color. Why do we do that? So that it stands out in the chart. Mm-hmm. So that if it's posted on the refrigerator in your house, it's obvious. It can't be missed. So for that reason, we print all these documents in this wild pink color. Takeaway points that I think important to emphasize about the form. First of all, completion of this form is entirely voluntary. You should not be required by any institution or insurance program to complete this form. It's an entirely voluntary process. The forms can be, once you have completed one, you change your mind, you don't agree with it anymore, these forms can be changed or revoked. That's a decision that can be made by the individual who completed them. This form is directing your treatment by the choices that you've made on the form. We want to emphasize that whatever treatment choices one makes, comfort is always provided. So, you know, there's no time that that's not appropriate. And lastly, the form doesn't become official or valid until it's signed by both the healthcare practitioner and the patient. So this is one of those rare situations where a medical order requires the signature of the patient, or if the patient can't do it on their own behalf, their healthcare agent. Is it time to look at some of the specific sections? Is this a good time to do that, or do you have some questions of it?
I think we can take a look at the specific sections of the form.
So you can see at the top of this, and I wanted to highlight some points that are important. This form goes with a person wherever they are transferred or discharged. So one of the positives about the POLST form is that it's transferable. So when the patient moves from one healthcare setting to another, the form goes with them. So if they go from the hospital to rehab, or the hospital to skilled nursing, or the hospital to any kind of home setting, personal care, independent living, their own home, this form goes with them so that it goes wherever the patient is. So the portability of the form is extremely important. Under current law, under Act 186, if EMS comes and sees a limitation on resuscitation, they are required under current law to call their command physician to get approval. We are trying to change that through some proposed legislation, but that's the situation right now. The form is valid when it has the appropriate information in terms of name and date of birth on it that you see there, and a decision is made by the patient or the surrogate about whether they want or do not want cardiopulmonary resuscitation. So the form will not be valid if either yes or no is not checked on this form. So one of those has to be made. If the person is not going to make a choice, then this is not an appropriate form. You just be guided by their advance directive, whatever that says. But I think that the most valuable section of the form is in B. Again, it doesn't require completion for it to be a valid form, but I think we do the patient a disservice if we don't complete this section with the patient. And as you can see on the screen, it describes three levels of care: comfort measures, limited additional interventions, and full treatment. Now, most of us, when we're healthy, are clearly going to pick full treatment, and that is the expectation. And if you don't fill this section out, you will get full treatment. Any section of this form that is not filled out, you get full treatment. That is the default position in Pennsylvania. Now, what do we mean by comfort measures? Well, this is a patient who has decided that comfort is the thing that's most important to them for whatever reason. They don't want to go back to the hospital. They don't want to go to the intensive care unit. They don't want to be on a breathing machine. They may still have requested cardiopulmonary resuscitation, and that would be in conflict. Okay, so if you're going to have cardiopulmonary resuscitation, you can't check comfort measures only, because by its very nature, cardiopulmonary resuscitation requires those life-saving support measures. But for the person who has indicated that they don't want cardiopulmonary resuscitation, they can choose any one of these. They can choose full treatment. I frequently remind people that do not resuscitate or do not attempt resuscitation does not mean do not treat. Mm-hmm. So the patient could choose no resuscitation but still request full treatment. The limited additional interventions is typically the patient who's willing to go back to the hospital for limited interventions, but typically not life-sparing interventions like ventilators or cardiopulmonary resuscitation. But they might go back for antibiotics or blood products or treatment of pain issues and that type of thing. They typically wouldn't go to an intensive care unit. And then full treatment is what people expect when they go to a hospital. Every appropriate intervention that can be made would be covered by the full treatment aspect. Any confusion there? Any thoughts that we need to clarify for our viewers that you can think of?
Just a thought. As I listen to you talk about the POLST form, and I'm aware of other forms that honor patients' end-of-life wishes,
right,
advance directives, and so on and so forth, and most of our listeners probably are as well.
Right.
I'm wondering, this sounds as if it has a lot more weight and potency than a typical advance directive, and yet in researching this over the past few days, I've learned that it's used rather erratically, and I'm wondering why that's the case, Dr. Yeah. Kimball.
Yeah, Kathleen hits a point. We have been working for 10 years to try to make this widely adapted throughout the state of Pennsylvania. And in the 62 counties, it varies from pretty active implementation. Some counties, like I would consider Berks, kind of partial implementation. In some counties where it's not used at all. And I see it as predominantly an education issue.
Mm-hmm.
So we still have a lot of work to do. We think that our legislative proposals might help that problem. But
okay. We are, I don't know if this number was flashed on the screen in the beginning, but we are taking calls at 610-378. 0426, and I just wanted to mention that. Is there something else in this section that you wanted to address, Dr. Kimball?
No, I think the sections C and D are typically not emergent issues, and there's really a lot of discussion in our national program about whether, particularly the section on antibiotics, is necessary. So again, the section C, which deals with antibiotics, the individual has the choice of either receiving no antibiotics, or a trial of antibiotics, or use of antibiotics, as it says here, if life can be prolonged. Many of us are not sure that this is something that's required on this form, and there is some discussion at the national level about removing that section. We'll see what happens. But right now on the state form in Pennsylvania, which is part of the national program, it is still on our form. And then Section D deals with artificial nutrition and hydration. And this is a very important issue in Pennsylvania because our state law under 189 is very clear that unless an individual has made an express statement about their feelings with regard to this, that they absolutely must feed, must receive nutrition, etc.
Mm-hmm.
So it is that's why this section is here, because this then becomes an explicit expression by the patient as to whether they want a feeding tube or don't want a feeding tube, or the middle category there, which is the trial period of artificial hydration and nutrition. So that is a section that we hope people will complete. Again, any of these sections that are not completed, the default is that they will receive full treatment in that section. So they will receive the antibiotics if they hadn't made a choice, and they will receive potentially a feeding tube or IV fluids.
But this is a fluid form, and you can complete it and change it at any time.
Absolutely. So it can be modified or entirely revoked anytime you want to.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And then the last section that I point out speaks in part to what we said earlier about the importance of a conversation. This section requires that the individual who has the conversation with the patient, typically one of the healthcare team, the nurse practitioner, the physician assistant, or the physician, indicate on the form with whom they had the conversation. So most commonly it's going to be the patient, but if the patient can't speak for him or herself, it might be the parent of a minor, it could be their healthcare agent as indicated here, it could be a court-appointed guardian, it could be a significant other, Okay, there are provisions in the law that significant others can serve as a healthcare agent or healthcare representative. And then there's a section there where people can indicate specific goals for care. I want to attend my daughter's wedding in 1 month. I want to attend my grandson's bar mitzvah, whatever, okay? And also, there may be special medical conditions. So the Jehovah's Witness might put in here that they don't want any blood products. Mm-hmm. So that can be indicated in other sections of the form as well, but this would be another place that they could indicate that. So then the bottom of the form are the signatures that are required so that the clinical practitioner, the nurse practitioner, the physician assistant or physician would sign it and print their name and provide a phone number where they can be reached so that any member of the healthcare team needs to clarify any of the issues knows how to reach them. And then you see there's a signature by the patient at the bottom of the page, and again where they print their name and indicate mm-hmm. whether it was they that signed it or a healthcare agent. And that's what makes the form valid, is those signatures and then the completion at a minimum of Section A.
So there are many takeaways here, and one of them that I hear is the importance of the conversation. And
absolutely. You know, I didn't mention Woody Allen earlier, but he, as one of my most favorite statements is, I'm not afraid to die, I just don't want to be there when it happens. And I think that captures where most of us are in terms of talking about our own mortality. We don't want to have that conversation. Mm-hmm. So as you know, Kathleen, we spend a lot of time at the Coalition talking mm-hmm. about the importance of conversation. Mm-hmm. So absolutely key. We need to sit around the kitchen table or wherever your favorite place is mm-hmm. with the key people that would be making decisions for you. Again, I probably didn't make the point clear enough that that advance directive does not become effective unless you cannot speak on your own behalf. Mm-hmm. So, but if that situation arises and you can't speak on your own behalf, you want to be sure that the people that are going to be making decisions on your behalf with the healthcare team know exactly what you want. And again, the concept of this is a substituted judgment. I may be the healthcare agent for my wife, and if she can't speak for herself, the decision I make is not one I would make for myself. Mm-hmm. I make that decision for her based on her values, her choices that she has indicated to me either through the conversation or on the advance directive or on the POLST form. So that's what we mean by substituted judgment.
It looks as if we're about to wrap up this evening, Dr. Kimball. I know there's a lot more information to share. And we have a flyer.
Well, let me just point out, before you jump
before
to the flyer,
that.
So I wanted our viewers to be able to get additional information. So we posted here the link to the website, and I'm just put up a screenshot for what you'll see when you go to that website. And there's information about the form itself. There's information for patients and families and for healthcare professionals and a link to the national program. So I hope that our viewers will find that useful.
I hope so too. And once again, Dr. Kimball will be providing much more information on this topic on November 7th at the McGlynn Center at Alvernia University at 8:15 a.m. The flyer is appearing now. And we invite everyone to come. It's free of charge. There will be coffee and a light breakfast, and all are welcome. And just in closing, Dr. Kimball, I'd like to thank you for sharing all
of
this information. It's very valuable. I know that it's important to you, and you've spent a great deal of time researching it mm-hmm. and working on legislation.
Yes.
And there's much more for us to hear. And I think it's time to say goodbye.